I do want to welcome our guests tonight. There are a number of guests, and thank you to our experts who have arranged for those people to join us. Again, sadly, some of those people weren't well. Andrew Barth had looked across for someone to meet us, and they were downstairs in a car feeling unwell, and we've told them for obvious reasons to keep away, so they'll come next month. But thank you for making the effort to get James to join us. So just for those of you that haven't been here before, I just wanted to run through an agenda for you. 2 o'clock, welcome and housekeeping. We generally, sadly, do sort of push over time. I'm trying to get things sorted to make sure that that doesn't happen in the future. It's only taken me 8 years and we're still struggling with it. At 2:10, I'm just very close thereafter. Jeff Outman's going to talk to us about and give us an economist's perspective on where these things at, but also talk about some opportunities for you guys and some threats and considerations that you'll need to take to mind. We're going to have a break. Again, that might be a little bit after 5 to 3, but there'll be a break, an opportunity for a leisure stretch, coffee. Please, throughout, help yourself to tea, coffee, and water from the water stand. Traditionally, we put bottles on here, and last month when I threw catch box, which I'll be doing today, we put a drink all over. This ground is not very forgiving, but it's okay. No, it's okay, Andrew. Keep it down on the ground, mate. But just help yourself to any of the refreshments up there. Andrew Barth and Richard Alston are going to present to us around recruitment and recruitment strategy, and to sort of debunk the myth that there is a thing called the recruitment tree that sits out the back of everyone's building, which I'm really looking forward to. Have another break, short brief break, and then we'll work in and break into the Ask the Expert sessions. For those of you that have been here before, you know exactly what happens. Members and guests stay at table, should be allocated a table, then the slide will be up, and experts will come to you, so there's nothing you need to do other than that. And we're going to trial something. Wendy and Jeff are going to help us. There'll be a group that will be pulled out and extracted out to the front of the cafe at 4 o'clock, which is shortly thereafter, and we're going to be running a session called Leveraging Leaders. And that's something a little bit different, and it's really about trying to identify opportunities within the group for each other. So we'll talk about maybe an issue that's confronting you, an opportunity that's now before you, or what the perfect client might look like in the case of you looking to grow and develop your business. So Wendy and Jeff will help facilitate those conversations, and then we'll be soliciting feedback during the course of the evening. And then finally, drinks and cheddar pays. It will start slightly after 5 again. And thank you to Elias Gerasati, 11 Hill, and Benson's Property Group for supplying the wines for this evening, and made by Misty, our wonderful caterers. And they'll be joining us shortly to provide you with the cheddar pays for this evening. And we conclude on or about 6:30, but I'll leave you guys to judge that. So without any further ado, I'd like to hand over to Jeff Outman, who's a very dear friend, someone on our advisory board, an economist, used to work at the Reserve Bank, the National Australia Bank, and now runs his own consulting business called Economics and Beyond. For those of you that had the opportunity to hear Jeff in his rather unusual style talk to us during the course of COVID, he was pretty much on the money in everything he said, so I've asked him to come back and just sort of push forward on all that. So without any further ado, Jeff, over to you, mate.
Thanks, Rob. Thanks, Rob. So I'm a macroeconomic and financial guy who honours the economic and financial and sort of political system and keeps an eye on those big picture risks. And because, you know, every now and then some of those big unexpected events, they could be good, positive or negative, come along and can blow you up or create a headwind for your business. So when I used to be involved in rating credit risk inside National Australia Bank, sort of this macroeconomic stuff that I talk about used to blow up or significantly impact about 10 to 15% of businesses. And we've just been through one of the most unprecedented shocks that I'd done scenario planning around 10 years ago and hoped that it was just a temporary SARS event. But we've had more than a temporary virus event, but there's actually probably some longer term structural changes that you must keep an eye on, because the world has changed. And what does that new normal look like? So we're going to do a bit of that. But before I do that, I want to actually ask what are the questions that are at the top of your mind in the macroeconomic and financial environment right now? Because I've got 40 slides here, and yeah, death by PowerPoint, and Rob can send them out and put them up on the website, and it tells a story. You could go home tonight with a bottle of red, hopefully could read that and draw out the major implications for you and your business. But sort of, what are the ones at the top of your head? Because I'd like to touch on them along the way, because I'd rather talk about the things that you want to, that are top of mind right now. So we've got one gentleman here who wants to kick me off. Excessive debt.
Sorry, one of the things I should have said, Jeff, is that there's a microphone at the front. Wendy's got one, and I'll be throwing this around shortly. Make sure everyone speaks to the microphone because the sound is somewhat difficult here.
Next.
Mine was related to exactly that, but on a global sense. If every country around the world is racking up enormous debt, how do we worry about that? I mean, does it just get wiped clean, or what does that actually mean?
Yeah. But yeah, keep going.
Inflation. I'm just curious about that. Interest rates and inflation.
Yeah.
Yeah. Touching on that.
I'm worried about climate and the lack of government climate policy.
Jeff, you've got a few there that look at the glass very empty with excessive debt. I'll look at it the other way. How long does stimulus campaign spend?
So, just for clarity there,
how much stimulus is the government going to continue with?
Oh, yeah, that's it. Central bank, yeah, it's government, central banks. And government. And you know who? Households have got about $240 billion just sitting in their pockets in the bank. Yeah. So in that thing, there's households as well, because they've got a truckload of precautionary savings here.
Jeff, you mentioned at the start about the structural changes that might have occurred as a result of COVID. There has been a shift. I'm interested to know what you think are some of those early structural changes. I guess how we think about debt is clearly going to be one of them.
Yeah. I've got a long list of structural changes.
So I've got two, if I can help. So one is Bitcoin, and the other is more of a reminder with the Israeli-Palestinian China.
Well, I call it the GCC. That's the Great Corona Crisis. Plus cyber war, plus China, plus, and you're interested in this stuff called crypto or e-money. All right.
And property
plus.
Yeah, property.
Because some of this might end up being over Q&A at the end, or even I'll be about later in the day. So I don't. But that's a great start, because that's the type of things I should be able to help you with. Yeah. So let's just sort of start at the start and go. Yeah, the GCC plus C plus C plus. So COVID. Now we've sort of been through that, or have we? Because, you know, there's mutations, and is it just going to, the assumption that's built into everybody's minds right now is that it just turns into a endemic, just like the flu. And we learn how to treat, we get vaccinated, we'll have treatments, and we'll probably need a booster every now and then. So when we're looking at this a year ago online together, I asked the question, when will we be back together? And after everybody made their guess, I said, maybe never. Now, we're back together in Australia, but we're certainly not back together as the world as a whole, are we? So if you're dealing with some emerging economies right now, it's pretty hard to deal with them. And it's pretty hard to put together a car right now. So who's been to get a car lately? Well, there's not none on the showroom floor. So, you know, so we've got to get through that rollout phase and that herd immunity phase, and hopefully the mutations that are occurring in India right now, because that's what happens when a virus gets to the population out of control. It's smart, this virus, but I hope we're smarter. The politics and policy of cold wars. I mean, we're part of the five spies, aren't we? We've been spying on China for how long? And they're spying on us. And the panda bear walked up, the koala bear walked up to the panda bear and went, and said, "Help me, black bear." All right, we're the koala bear in this, and we're poking the panda bear. So we've got trade wars, finance wars, climate wars, cyber wars, and do we end up in a hot war? I actually very happy that the most Google search in the world in Australia last year, I believe, was Trump, and it's no longer there. We're back to make love, not war. Diplomacy, okay? So that's taken the tips out. China, you know, I say get up every morning and go China, but yeah, I've been saying that for how long, Rob? 20 years. And it's fantastic when it comes in the form of red gold prices at $200 a tonne. But it won't be fantastic when pig iron, remember pig iron, Bob? We sold the Japs pig iron and they gave it back to us. So, and look, this excess debt, asset bubbles, when you leave interest rates down this low, are you going to end up in unintended consequences of asset bubbles? Are property prices a bubble? Who thinks it's a bubble? Who thinks the residential property market in Australia is a bubble? Put up your hand, come on. That looks like, who doesn't know? Okay, and who said it's not a bubble? We're in the minority. Alright? We're in the minority. I'll tell you why it's not a bubble. There's more than that at play, but when we get the property prices. But what I've really got to say is, when crazy economists or treasurers or central bankers get up, they've got a base case, and I'll take you through the base case, but there's heaps of uncertainty and risk around this, just on that board. So any good business person has a base case, but they've got to take risk mitigation strategies. All right? They've got to monitor those risks and have a mitigation strategy in place. Now, not a lot of people do that. You know, some people just drift through life. You know, about one in four people really think deeply about some of the big risks around their base case. And it can create opportunity. There's a lot of people that make money in one of the most unprecedented health shocks in 100 years. Right? And always, generally, you've got to keep an alert in these big systemic things for government policy actions, because they're the ones that sort of typically come in and help save you. So that's sort of the thing about the idea. You've got to think base case, think scenarios with risks, have risk mitigation strategies, and take advantage of the opportunities that arise. Now look, there's some charts here, and we're going to fly through it because, Rob, I've got, what time am I stopping? 3:00. All right, because I want to stop and answer questions at 2:45. So, you know, there's some charts here. This first one just shows you, wow, this measures economic policy uncertainty. Wow. All right, and it's still somewhat elevated. And the main issue that's elevated behind this driver is what's happening in China. All right. There's also issues with policy elsewhere, but mainly China. So go China, watch China carefully. So there's some very different scenarios that can occur here. You hear people using V, L, W, U that sound like cars to me. And the other thing that you touched on was, look, there's some structural changes that are going to come in. After we've been through the cycle, what's the world going to look like? How will it have changed? Because I want to not just get through the cycle, I want to position my business for really what happens in the medium to longer term. So to do that, you've got to sort of do the bit around monitoring. It's pretty simple, but you're not just going to monitor, you've got to get the knowledge. It's one thing to monitor. If you don't then scale to the point about the knowledge and advice you need to set up your strategy and your operational plans. So, yeah, still a bit of that. Look, there's stuff here on COVID, but I'm just sort of going to go past COVID because COVID's old story. And, you know, the big rescue packages that came out. And, the fiscal bazookas, that's led to massive increases in government debt around the world. So this is sort of saying that the US current account, fiscal position, government accounts is over adding 25% of GDP to its debt each year. Now, remember, here's Australia way down here. We're AAA rated, all right? So prior to the crisis, we had AAA rating, level of debt of around, net debt of around 30% of GDP, and people focus on debt. Remember, they don't always focus on the other side of the balance sheet, which is the wealth. So Australia's not only a debtor, but when you take into account the wealth, the land, the stuff in the ground, its people, we're a net wealth country. So we're AAA rated. We're one of the wealthiest countries in the world per capita. Do Australians understand that? We're one of the wealthiest people in the world per capita. When you retire, you get almost $1 million promise from the government in an age pension, and you're going to get looked after on your health and other things through that journey. In Russia, you die at 62, your pension gets inflated away. What a great journey that was. All right? In Australia, you get to 82. Pretty good place. We're not only wealthy, we look after, that's another issue. I won't get an aged care. I am an aged care director in a not-for-profit. I do know that space. There are good ones, and there are ones that should have been run out of town. Anyhow, so there's debt. The fiscal bazookas went off, and debt's gone up. Now, how do you manage this? Well, when interest rate's 0.25%, you can service it, can't you? You can service it. Yep. So servicing is an issue. So how do you pay it back? By growing, generating income, and paying it back over time. Now, when the government borrows, it's not just that generation that pays for it back, but future generations that pay for it. It's an intergenerational problem. And the way you pay it back faster is lifting the underlying growth rate of the economy. Yeah? And to do that, you're going to make good spending. So there's such a thing as what I'd simply say is good debt and bad debt. Right, good debt that lifts the underlying productivity of the economy and encourages things to grow and invest. Bad debt. And some countries don't have a very good track record when they spend money. Right, some governments don't. Australians don't do too badly. And it's AAA rated. The other way you do away with debt is by inflating it away. Inflate it away. Now that's a pretty difficult thing to do these days because if you start to inflate your debt away, you're less competitive as a country and you won't sell as much to other countries and the capital will flee and your currency will fall and only make shit happen. Alright? So the whole world's going to inflate a little bit more this way because inflation's too low. But mainly through a bit higher inflation and stronger growth that you stabilise that debt over the next 20 years. This is the economics of it. The politics of it is something else. Remember, the politics of it up until a virus came in the room was government debt is all bad. bullshit. Right? Or I don't trust the government. Well, that means you're going to go without schools and a whole heap of services. You're going to get it back in tax cuts. You know, you're going to get it back in tax cuts. But, you know, what type of country would you like to live in? One that's going to generate a job for your grandkids, or one that you're going to tax cut today and not worry so much about your grandkids or your mum and dad that are in the aged care home? Place your vote. Very good politics. Shit house economics. All right. Now, central banks came along and bought it. They've come along and bought it, and that's to sort of keep interest rates down, because when the cash rate gets to zero, you can't do any more with that, so you've got to go up the yield curve and flatten the yield curve, and that's quantitative easing. And what it does, you get to zero on cash rates, well, you've got to do something to bond rates. Bond rates at 0.5%, 1%. Now, that's an opportunity if you've got a good business to lock in historically low interest rates, isn't it? So you should have been looking at your funding here to see, and you've seen what's happened in households here in Australia. There's been a massive shift from variable rate loans to fixed rate loans to take advantage of the change in the level, the very ultra low level of interest rates. So there's the cliff around the world, and there's the rebound. Look, Mother's Day last year was when you should have been recognising that the world was heading back in better shape by then. And what were the triggers? You had policymakers doing whatever you could. We'd learned to track and contain the virus. And then by November, we found that we think we've even got the vaccines. Now we've just got to produce them and get the boosters ready. And so financial markets and good businesses are looking through that, aren't they, and getting on. But the low, you should have started to do that in May last year, Mother's Day. All right? It's never too late. And here's, when you look at across country, you see, geez, I'm glad I'm not in the UK. Geez, I'm glad I'm not in Europe or Japan. Oh, here's Australia, almost recovered in an output sense, on average, because some sectors haven't, others have, from one of the biggest shocks, unprecedented health shocks you've ever seen in your life. So it's very uneven. So you've got this uneven recovery, and we've still got plenty of spare capacity right around the world. In Australia, we're actually, in some sectors, we're looking for workers, and the guys are going to take you through that piece later. But in others, there's spare capacity. We're still a long way from full employment or a world that's back on a strong growth path. And it's very uneven. Okay, so along come the Reserve Bank, and they make scenarios. And, you know, these are very different worlds. There's the world prior to COVID, with output expanding up there at a rate of about 3% or about $40 to $50 billion a year, generating jobs. Like down here, would have been down here, we would have been running into probably inflation and even a tighter labour market by now. But here we are, bang, when a bug walks in the room, and here we are with a labour market that's still got a bit of spare capacity on average, but more broadly, a fair bit of underutilisation. And wages. Wages got frozen, wages got cut. Yep. And we're starting to unwind a bit of that now. But as crazy macroeconomists see it, there's not a lot of wages pressure until you get through to full employment. So now we have a government that says debt's not a dirty word. We want to drive the unemployment rate to 4 to 4.5%. Well, my response to that is, the quicker, the better. But he's not playing the politics like that, is he? Because the quicker, the better, he would have had to spend more and do some reforms, and he didn't want to do either. Has he done enough to win the next election? Who thinks he'll win the next election? Who thinks he won't? really don't know. Who would like ScoMo out? We're not in Queensland because Queensland would say no, wouldn't it? You know, so he's not talking about climate change in Queensland, right? All right, so here we go. They're the type of things that I'm watching as a crazy economist. The one that I want you to watch, apart from the bargaining, is this one. Once a month, the second Tuesday of the month, get the NAB business survey because it asks you about how your business is going. And look, there's the shock horror of a killer bug walking into the room about over a year ago, and here confidence is back at record levels. Business confidence. Consumer confidence isn't back at record levels yet on average. And here you can see that it's quite different across sectors, with some sectors doing much better than others, and recreation, personal, construction and transport. And within the construction sector, there's a real myriad of experience, isn't there, between the residential sector, where it takes you 2 years to build a house in Ballarat right now. Hang on, I'll be back in 2 years. Now, but if we go in the CBD, there's a few flats down here, isn't there? Yeah. Not just the ones with fire stuff on the outside that need to be fixed. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's March. So the bug walked in the room in February, March. Yeah, this is the In fact, the way this is read, March is measured towards the end of March and it's printed as March. So this is, you know, because the bug was at its worst. I mean, bond, yeah. So this is March. So here's April. Okay. So, yeah. So if you were smart, you could see that it, that was. Well, if you were monitoring, I should say, smart. If you were monitoring these things, you could see. Then there's the labour market, and I'm not going to head into there, but it's Australia, the unemployment rate's back to a bit over 5. Job levels are back to where they're above pre-COVID. Some of that's about expats coming home and doing their overseas work in Australia from here. But the sectors where you've had the growth has been in public admin and safety, financial services, some parts of utilities, you know, and some parts of healthcare. But others still haven't got back to levels of a year ago. So it's there's been some winners and there's been some losers. Well, so, and I'm on policy watch, just as I said. I mean, these are the things that I'd like to see governments do to lift productivity that we haven't seen much of for a little while. So let's go and look at some of those structural changes that I said if the world's changed. And there's a number of things happening here. It's not just COVID. There's climate change, isn't there? One of the questions here. There's a lot of technology, digitisation, and this artificial intelligence stuff happening. And then there's these geopolitics that are changing too. So there's some really big drivers making some big changes here. And, of course, what's happened with the structural change in debt and monetary policy as well. So there's some big structural drivers here. So they've pretty much changed the way we do things in Australia now. And what's some examples? The sensitivity of house prices, the key drivers are interest rates, yeah, and whether you've got a job, all right? So if we go back pre-COVID, interest rates now are 2%, 1.5% to 2% lower. The elasticity on that is 8%. So that's worth 8 times 1.5 to 2. That's worth 10 to 15% on the property market. And the unemployment rate is where it was. Yeah, and money's back easy. So what I'm saying, that the funding side is encouraging this. Indeed, it's got to a point where it's cheaper to buy than to rent. All right, that's the Q ratio. It was cheaper to buy than to rent, except in in some places. So that's put a bonfire under this and the point, but people love to do this thing. Record, you know, it's only got back to where it was in 2017, so you did have the opportunity to buy at these lows of last year. I was trying to get my son to buy property in the second half of last year, and he was too busy doing other things. Right? Industrial property, that's a real mixed bag now, because, you know, the warehousing piece is really on fire. And look at what's happening to retailing and the big increase in retailing online. And of course, look at the office space and CBDs. There's structural things at play there. And in the labour market, are these temporary or structural changes? Look what's happened to population growth. If you close borders, we're normally going to have it in something of the order of a couple of 125,000 migrants a year. At the moment, it's running at an annual rate of minus 44. We're short people. I mean, didn't mean short, but we're short people. Yeah. And look over here. We see that the job vacancy rate to unemployment has never been so high. So the unemployment rate's come down and job vacancy's gone up. But, you know, this is the stuff that the guys are going to get into later. But it's pretty tight because applicants per vacancy are really quite at historical lows in some of these sectors. Yeah. So finding the right person is getting harder. And some of those sectors are obviously in accommodation, food, some in construction and services, and agriculture, and the guys are going to go into that, I think. Then the other structural change is in you can see, is in the listed market. So this just shows share prices all around the world. So the bottom line here is that's the world index, that's the tech index. Okay, there's the Aussie index, and there's the Aussie tech index. And there's the, here's the Aussie index and here's the Aussie tech index. What I'm trying to show you here is that there's been a structural change in the way we value things. All right? And they're not just pure tech companies, are they? Yeah? So when you go to the Aussie techs, you'll see Seek. You'll see cloud guys. You'll see a whole heap of people that have digitised things and increasing using artificial intelligence to go to market, to produce things and go to market. So that's another, but that was occurring prior to COVID, but look what happened. The COVID vault did it post-COVID. It's been accelerated by this bug walking into the room. So that's a key, and you know, you can go and see it. You can see it in Australia, some of the companies. And some of the winners and some of the losers. And there's climate change. It's you know, the way I see it right now, we've finally got political catch-up taking place and even leadership in some places now. Yeah, even Boris won't let you buy a gas guzzler anymore. Right. Even Boris is saying you can't produce gas or coal-driven power. What did we do? Announced today? We're going to do a gas one. Sorry, you and me are going to pay for a gas one. Yeah, it's probably going to be out of date before it even gets... turnkey gets turned. I hope not. Yeah. And so... it's happening, and investors and companies aren't waiting for governments. And, so good companies now are building in shadow prices for carbon and transitioning into that world. They know what their carbon footprint is. They have an idea of what's going to cost them to become carbon neutral, and they're factoring it into their longer-term business plans. If you really... that's one of the great websites in the world, you know, the McKinsey's Institute. Around not just climate change, but a lot of the big issues that businesses are faced with, and they'll send you a one-page alert on what's going on there. So I hope I've sort of shown you that there's some key risks to keep an eye on here. I hope I've sort of convinced you that the baseline doesn't look too bad, but you should still be stress testing your base case. Asset bubbles. All right. This is how I keep an eye out for asset bubbles, be it in crypto or in a housing market. First, you've got to find, is there excessive credit? Is there, banks falling over you themselves to give you money? All right? Is there excessive credit? And would you say there is in Australia? No. It's about a month delay to get even an approval out of the bank for some. Don't even get me started. I mean, these are profitable loans. So, and they stress test you for interest rates at 4.5% to 5% now, so they're not getting as much as you might like, because you just can't save as fast as market's rising. All right? These slow approvals kill you. Go see the bank of mum and dad. And that's the fifth biggest bank in Australia now. And ScoMo will give you a guarantee. So you don't, for if you've got no money. Yeah, so that's a pretty good deal. Go take advantage of the government's good deals. Are there excessive prices and low rents and yields? Well, you've got to have some fundamental model, and the answer is no. Because there's a shortage of supply, and interest rates are falling in real terms again, and prices are probably going to go up by 10 to 15% over the next, the timing of it you never know, but over the next couple of years. Is there an excess supply of the asset? It takes 2 years to build a place in Ballarat. No. Are there exuberant buyers? Yeah, bit of man. If you go out in the Melbourne market, you find that there's 1.5 people left standing which they bought the property. So there is a bit of exuberance, and there are more buyers than sellers still out there. But is it happening in farmland? Gosh, you've seen what's happening in farmland. So some of this is simply that real interest rates have fallen so low, and that's what's capitalising the cash flows. So there's farmers sitting up on the Queensland border that haven't had a cash flow until this recent rain for 5 years, and their farms have been going up, a 10 million farm's been going up at $1 million a year. And he's been sitting inside the farm doing nothing. That's what's driving that, the fall in real interest rates. Because somebody one day is going to come along and generate a lot of food and cotton on that land, especially if it's got water. So my action plan here is sort of go and give yourself some time. You've got a base case. Give yourself some time to stress test it. And then look at the cash flows and what's going to happen under. And check your bank funding here, because there's a real opportunity here to lock in some really good funding for a number of years. And you also want to know what it is, because when shit happens, that's when you do get knocked on by the bank. So you should know this. Anyhow, you know these things. Stress test for high interest rates. It's going to be 2 to 3% higher sometime down the year, sometime down the track. My forecast for interest rates, somebody asked for. The central bank's waiting and watching right now, and it's signalling. It talks to you, it's called forward guidance, and they're saying, I don't think I have to raise interest rates to 2024 at the earliest. And in the meantime, it's taken away some of that quantitative easing support it gave to longer term money, so 3 year money and 5 year money and 10 year money. So they're starting to rise a bit. But variable rates, if you believe the central banker, aren't going up for 2 to 3 years, in 2 or 3 years. Take advantage of these policy responses. As you probably know, there's big write-offs out there. There's job maker, job trainer. You know, there's the government's, trying to help you. And as I said, watch out for bubbles. I'm not going to get into the operational things, because that's sort of where I think. I've been talking about the macro things. You know, this is where businesses really make their money. And so if you want to stay in touch with this, as I said, go to here once every month and get the business survey. Go to here once every 6 months and see what the IMF, an independent source, is saying about the world. If you like to follow global politics, go to Project Syndicate, and this McKinsey Institute is a great source of just all business stuff. And this is my sort of theme around for here around Vic Leaders. You come to Vic Leaders for three things. Well, I think of it as a crazy old bloke. And first, to bond. Right, because when you bond, it lowers the transaction costs of doing deals. You build trust. You know, you can bond in bed. You can bond over a contract. You can bond over, you know, whatever way you like to bond. So you create bonds. But after you bond, you've got to seek knowledge. Knowledge. Not noise. You've got to just stay away from fake news. Stay away from noise. You've got to seek knowledge. And the third thing you really need is be able to exchange it. Now, you don't necessarily exchange that in a marketplace, you know, that way. But you can exchange in many ways. But typically, you exchange in your businesses through the marketplace, because that's how you create value and generate wealth. So that's what Vic Leaders is, and why I joined it with Rob. You know, it's a number of years now. We've had lots of people come through. They've bonded, yeah, lower search costs, builds trust and capital. Then they share knowledge. They transfer knowledge about each other. Because it's not about noise or fake news. It's about knowledge. You know where you can find good advice and knowledge in the room here. And then you go and exchange it, because that's what generates the value and the wealth creation. You don't network. Network never generated nothing, all right, except the hangover, all right? So I know the wine's good here, Rob, but at the end of the day, it's about, they're the three key things that I think Vic Leaders brings to businesses and leaders like yourselves. So I've got that. You know, if you ever need any help from me, that's where you'll find me. I think I've sort of touched on the excessive debt one, but you've got to think of it at a country level. And when you see a country running a current account deficit of the order of 6%, 5 to 6% of GDP continuously, that means they're borrowing from somebody else in the world. So for everybody who's got a current account deficit, somebody's got a current account surplus. So who are the countries that have got current account surpluses? The Chinese. Yeah. The Germans. Yeah. Does Australia have a current account surplus? Yeah. For the last year and a half, for the first time in since the Korean War, when commodity prices were through the roof and we're riding on the sheep's back, we're a saver. This country as a whole is saving, even though the government's got a record level of dis-saving taking place. Where's it sitting? It's sitting in the households, in banks. So the key driver of the recovery here is when that consumer confidence gets taken down the supermarket. And I don't mean the supermarket, I mean the supermarket. And spent, all right? It gets spent because that'll pick up growth, it'll use up the spare capacity. You'll need to go and find more people that create jobs. You'll need to go and get investment, and we'll get back to full employment quicker. But at the moment, that's the person who you're really watching to kick in, other than the price of red gold. Because what the price of red gold did was funded that deficit, that government's deficit, and the things that they gave you. So excessive debt, not in Australia. Keep an eye on the national picture, and when interest rates are low, it's not a problem. And if governments are going to grow and pay it back, they're the ones you want to be involved in. I talked about monetary policy, wait and watch, and gradually going to take away the punch bowl. Climate policy, that's, I definitely need a drink to have with whoever wants to talk about that this afternoon. Stimulus, we've talked about. The structural changes, we've talked about. Oh, crypto money. That's a longer story, but I don't have time for crypto money. It's a bubble, all right? crypto money's a bubble. The private money there is a bubble. Don't be the last person standing. Because you know why it's a bubble? The government's going to come into that market. So it's only it's a good bubble. It's a good bubble for crooks, because you know you don't have to show the government what you're doing. And it's getting hard to money launder. But it costs you more in carbon credits to go mine it than what it's worth. All right, it's a bubble. Watch out, the government, when it comes to this market. So, but you'll see them coming, won't you? Property prices, we're done. Am I all done? I think I'm all done, but unless you want, I'm in your hands, right?
Any last questions, Luke?
I'm happy to take questions. Rob will shut me up, and then I'll be about. So,
thanks for your presentation. You talk about the virus that walked in the room. As a result of that, last year, my job fell out from underneath me in the space of a week and cost $25,000 off my base salary. So, you can appreciate with young kid, I'm nervous about economics. I don't often get to speak to someone with your expertise.
Yeah.
But a two-part question. Given that the US runs on a fractional reserve economy, and there are some economists that say that the US has more debt than there is money to pay it back in the system, and that when the US coughs, we get the flu, what effect potentially is how big an effect will the US economy have on us, given that they've just gone on a massive spending spree and I don't know that they've got enough money to pay that back?
This is again a bit about whether it's excessive or not, all right? And my view is it's probably not. And because two things, they're all still the most productive place in the world, all right? One of the most productive places in the world. So when they go to work, they generate more income and they've got a higher underlying productivity. They've got low inflation, and over a long period of time, they'll pay it back. All right. The second thing is they got guns. So, when everybody's scared, where's the money run to? The guns. Yeah, they got more guns. So they're the world's international reserve currency. Like 80% of the world's central bank money is held in US assets. So they get to fund that excessive borrowing at a much cheaper rate than what Australia would, given they've got guns. Yeah. So that for them, the rate, the real rate of interest there at the moment, when you do the calculation, crazy economists, -1%, and they're growing at 2.5%. So in other words, they can afford to pay back the debt. Now it's gone higher and it becomes harder, but they're a long way from it becoming excessive relative to their level of interest rates and their growth potentials and their guns is the way. So, and we're back at the black bear, aren't we? We're not poking the black bear, we're poking the panda bear.
Yeah,
we'll
pick up. Last question, please.
Mine's about the panda bear, actually. I'm just curious. You talked about the US dollar being that underlying currency. Obviously, China's military is growing. They're getting more guns. The geopolitical area is changing here. What kind of timelines you see on that, and what are some of the major shifts that's going to create in the region as they get undermined as the world
border? I don't sleep with Premier Lee. I watch his behaviour, and if they really wanted to start a war, they've had a couple of opportunities to do it. Like Taiwan's just a little short right across the. And, Hong Kong fell in their lap because the Hong Kongians said, oh, we don't want you, and started, and they went in and said, well, you've got us now. So they did it peacefully, and nobody stopped them. Now, then we come to debate, will they go into Taiwan? Probably not. But one day, they will. Oh, what for? I don't know. wars going on. There's all these cold wars going on, and the big one that we have to keep an eye on, and they're signaling it now. They're finally saying that they're going to go and just start to invest in other places going on. The next one off the rank is they do the LNG plants, all those LNG plants that we built from around the north of the plant, that boom. Who they sell their gas to? If it's not into China and Japan. Yeah. So, yeah, we're a very different place if China decides to move away from this in an economic sense. And, that's not. Because Australia's this place where we grow a bit faster in real terms. And economists often talk about in real terms, but the return's higher because what we're selling has high prices. So our real income grows at about 2.5 to 3%, but our nominal income's growing at 6 to 8%. And that's where the extra cash flow comes for your BHP and Rio dividend and your income tax cut. Yeah, out of those nominal cash flows. And what's the iron ore price and what's China? But on everybody's best guess, China can't do that for another 3 years. All right, so I'm still on Rio and BHP.
What he's saying now is Jeffrey House. Now, we're going to have a two-minute break, so 3:15 back here and seated. Please help yourself to tea, coffee, and water. I didn't say earlier that the convenience is just down the hallway to the right. Jeff will be joining us this evening for drinks, and so please, any questions that remain unanswered, I'd still like to him and ask those questions. Thanks so much.
Testing. Okay, got it. Yep.
I could just ask that you grab yourselves a drink and get yourselves back to your tables. We'll get things underway in 1 minute. Just ask that you take your seats and we'll get things underway.
I'm turned on, but I don't know whether anybody can hear me. So the other scenario that happens is that what we may find is pressure on wages growth as well, which is what the government is trying to happen. I mean, I spoke to someone the other day, Andrew, that were in cybersecurity, and they've had there's no cybersecurity people here. So typically you get somebody at $650 a day, but because we've got nobody coming in, that same candidate is earning, or that same person is earning double that, $1,200 a day. That's just purely because there's nobody around to do that work. So wages pressure comes from lack of immigration. Would you agree with that, John?
Yeah. I think you've got the people coming in from overseas, which plays a big part in that in terms of the markets, particularly for hospitality, farming, call centres, that'll play a massive part, and also within the technology space, and you can see that a little bit, and I'll talk very quickly to these graphs. That's an application per job, which you can see has dropped, but applications per job on SEEK are at the lowest level they've been since 2012, yet the number of jobs advertised on SEEK is the highest in the history. So that makes a massive difference with regards to when you go to market, how you go to market, and what we really want to talk to about today is the opportunity that's there. So whilst all of that's bad news, that actually presents an opportunity for businesses who have their process right, know their story, and can run their interview process that much better than anyone else to get competitive advantage of the people that are available in the market. And there's more available than probably it looks like. If you look at applications to SEEK, that just means that there's not people necessarily looking on SEEK, and there's something that Richard and I would look at a lot, and that's passive candidates. That's the candidates who aren't going to look on SEEK or aren't going to look on LinkedIn. So how do you actually get to those candidates? I don't know if you see that as much as you're
I find in executive search that the my talent pool is very similar to my client pool. So my clients are my passive candidates all the time. So my job really is to expand that entire ecosystem, if you like.
Yeah, so I guess what we want to do now is get a feel for what your process when you do go to market looks like now. So we're going to do a little exercise on the tables in terms of whether that's groups of four or groups of two. And what does your current process look like at the moment? So some of the things you might want to think about is when you actually start your recruitment process. What's important to you when you recruit? How long does your process take? How do you source people currently? And then what are you hiring for? There's a lot of different questions there, but probably the key pieces on those to look at are when does it start? And then how long does the actual process take? Because they're probably the two pieces I think that are the easiest for you to change if you do need to change them. So if we could take, say, 5 minutes and maybe just work in pairs, if you can, just to look at those, how you look at your recruitment process currently. And then what we'll do is we'll get a couple of people to volunteer and share what their recruitment process looks like at the moment. Time starts now.
Thank you.
perhaps. Okay, sorry. Hello, everyone. If we can just come back to the front, otherwise I'm going to have Rob on my tail telling me I need to hurry up. So no one wants Rob chasing him. Yeah, we're going to use that. I'll write on the board. We're going to get back into this and get some people to share some ideas around their process at the moment. And everyone's process will be slightly different. They'll be at slightly different stages in terms of how they go about things. But who would like to start us off? Oh, Wendy.
Hello. Okay, so we have major issues to employ staff. So
where are you employed staff?
We're in the cleaning maintenance industry, and we are struggling to find employed staff. So normally, as a rule, what we do is we put something online for SEEK. We bring them in as group interviews. We get them in as group interviews. I never tell them that I'm one of the owners. We make out as if we're just, I'm the manager, and he's my boss. Because again, I find putting them in group interviews, you get to see what their personality relates, you see different personalities. So I sell the company on how good we are, on how we started, and how James started. And then James comes out and does a spill on what's expected, what we do, and how we do things. And then we get them to do group, we divide them in groups and do things like we just did now. And that way we walk around the room, we can see, we give them scenarios to work out, we see who's weak, who's strong, because with us it's all about teamwork. 2020 June, we won a very big contract and a job advertised for SEEK. We got 2,000 applicants. 3 weeks, 4 weeks ago, we put another ad in. We got 100 applicants out of 200, two that had quality. We hired them, one in particular went on Thursday. Lied on his resume and his references lied for him. So that's the challenge we're getting. We're finding it hard to find quality workers that want to work and we're doing everything above board. So what we've done now is we are approaching all of our staff, because we've got some amazing staff, and we're just saying to them, do you know anybody that is looking for work? I just need someone as good as you.
Yeah. And you know what? With recruitment, that's generally, if you go back to, I was reading something the other day, miners in Newcastle in the UK, that was how they found people. customers, who do you know that wants to come down to mine? And that piece hasn't changed. You can put all the technology, the sense, and that in the world into the process, but it still comes down to people.
We've just found that dressing it up so much on advertising online, just not getting it.
Yep.
Just not getting it. We're getting too many money chasers.
Yep.
Close to 40. The other thing that we've done is we've got, we rely on international students, they're the only ones that want to work. So with the shortage of them, we are struggling. So what we did is we got one of our Colombian girls to post on the Colombian community page, picked up three amazing staff members through that. I have got a couple of my Shulek staff members to put on their community pages, but they all have very good loyal workers. And because the Aussies don't want to work for $30 an hour. They don't want to get out of bed for $30 an hour. It's better on the dock. Yes, that's what we are doing
yep.
at the moment.
So it's really interesting what you're saying, because in executive search, which is completely the other end of the spectrum to what you're doing, we rely on people to give us recommendations for people and our networks to be able to do that. So what you're doing is you're doing what we're doing in executive search for your companies, and it's a really good strategy. Identify the best people in your organisation and get them to help you hire those people in, because good people know good people. That's what I say to my clients all the time, good people know good people. If I ask you for a decent plumber, if you don't know one, that's fine, but if Andrew knows one, you know, that's fantastic, and if Robert knows one, then that's great. And suddenly I've got myself a short list of three great plumbers, right? So that is how search works. So that's a really good strategy.
We actually have three different stories, but
yep.
to go over. My point of difference was saying, okay, I'd like to tell some of our clients, they spent a lot of money on their brand and ideas, and that was their own stuff like that. So long-term branding is basically being good to yourself, vice versa, having good exit reviews, and then growing your recruitment online, like having a careers page, and actually having testimonial, just like you market your own products, but have people doing it, marketing your own brand. So a lot of these big companies, like startups now, have heaps of content out there saying, come and work for us. So it's like, become the 110% money. That was fine. And then I think over here we had a small story where the own network.
Yeah, we use our own network agents.
Yes.
Because we're HR, IR managers, consulting in HR and IR. We're dealing with other HR and IR managers.
Yes.
So we know when they're getting paid.
Tony, you wanted to say something? Tony Nichols.
Yes, sir. Because we're hiring our people and externos, there's a couple of steps that we go through. So we've got a writing test and a pitching test. It's kind of important because if they can't write or pitch, we can't use them. So,
yep, there it is.
Yeah. But it's actually good because they deselected those steps. They look at the story or the case study and they often pull out just at that point, well, this is too heavy for us, which I don't mind. But the ones who get through the writing and the pitching, we're very keen to interview them. So then we interview them. It's usually my PR director, then me or us together. Then we reference checks and we put an offer in. I've hired four people this year. We're looking for another three. And it's an all-year thing. I've been doing this since I got back January 12th. It's not easy. Any tips, I'd really appreciate.
No, I think...
One of the things, one of the techniques we used was to actually incentivize employees to say, if you find someone and they stay for whatever period of time, 6 months or a year, we'll actually give you a bonus.
Yeah.
What that does is that they go out and they start talking up the company, and all of a sudden you become the employer of choice, and that's a really good way to go sometimes.
What it's worth, I know, having recruited in London, if you looked at all the investment banks in London, they all do that. And I think they pay, it's like £10,000 for every person that you bring in and refer, and they stay past their probation period. So it builds the loyalty. quality, but also, you're right, it gets people out there selling your story and why they work there and what have you. Just a quick question before I move on to the next slide, because I'm wary of time. In terms of timing, who starts the hiring process when they have a vacancy? Yeah. That would be the first one. And then whose process is nimble and you can change and move that quickly? So one. So I'll work through this. So in terms of process, that's how generally a pretty standard reactive recruitment process works. People get a vacancy on, and to use the analogy that Rob and I have talked about, they go out to the candidate tree that sits in the backyard and go, well, it's not got any fruit at the moment. What am I going to do? So then they'll generally go to Seek, try and find the candidate off Seek. You probably interview 3 to 5 people off whoever was on Seek, and however you've sorted through your Seek applications. I would not have wanted to be doing 2,000 Seek applications and working through those. Then you go through the interview, you offer, and you start. Actually, what you've done is the people who happen to look at that Seek ad at that particular moment in time, that's who you've ended up with. Were they the best person for your business that might have been available? Maybe, but I would suggest probably not. So, and there's obstacles in a process that are probably worth covering. Just quickly go through these. The best talent's going to be in high demand, so you've got to work out how you can source it, attract it, and retain it, which is some of the things we'll go through in a minute. The other thing is recruitment takes time. There isn't a tree out in the backyard. And definitely if there is a tree out in the backyard, it's not evergreen. It's not got candidates on it all year round. You'd be surprised the number of people who, when they go into a recruitment process, don't actually know what they want. So they go in and they don't know what they want. What skills do you want? What fit do you need? What attitude do you need from the person? And that's fine.
Yeah, there might be something along the lines, I'll need another Andrew. So
What does that mean?
I need another person that was like Andrew when he started with the company 5 years ago. I need another one like him. But he's just gone. So why do you need another one like him? He's gone because you can't offer him what Andrew wants anymore. Right? What you need is you need to think about what it is that you want your business to do and where your business is going. And then you need to hire that person, not another Andrew. Sorry, Andrew.
Quite right. I'm not getting hired. But on that, from that perspective, you need to know what I want. So if you are going to hire me, you need to know what I want. Is it dollars? Do I want flexibility? Is it the purpose of the company? What do I actually want? Before you start selling, you need to understand what the person wants. And that'll come down to a lot of parts of the process, from the what you've got up on your website, your advert, all of that will play into that. But then you've got that brand management piece, and that's hard. So I would say, like, if you look at your brand management, 2,000 people, it's hard to manage the brand in terms of, they all expect a response, particularly now. 200's a little bit easier to deal with. So you need to work out how you're going to manage that brand from that piece, because you want all those people going into the market, even if they get a no, as your ambassadors in the market, to sell your story. Because actually, I'd really love to work there, even though they said no. And then you've got to ask yourself, what if I can't find the right person? What if actually there's nothing on my tree, and there's nothing on the tree next door, and there's nothing in the orchard that's down the road? What are you going to do? What's your contingency plan?
Someone underneath who's kind of coming up.
Yep.
Now, I take the
football analogy. You build a list, you want people that are coming through, two people for each role where you can, or people that can step into that, or, and this will come on to the, it actually leads quite nicely onto the next slide, you need to know what's available in the market, if it's not there, so that when you need the person, you've already mapped the market and already know what's available. So you're actually talking to people the whole time. Recruitment's not a right now thing. It's in terms of, I need a person right now because someone resigned. What did you do 3 months ago, 2 months ago, a month ago to start building talent pools so that when you need someone, you're actually there ready to go? And potentially that stops you having to advertise on seats, so it doesn't take up as much time for you. It may be that you use different means to do that market mapping, that talent pooling, you get someone to do that for you, you get your internal person to do it for you, you go out, you find someone that you trust, whether it's a recruiter to do that for you, or you go and speak to, it could be a TAFE or educator in terms of, you've got students coming out of here all the time, who are your best students? So an example on that would be, actually I had a friend come and ask me with regards to, I need people, I cannot find them for this winery, and they also run a couple of hotels in the city. It's like, well, I just can't find people. So I've hooked them up with Torrens in terms of where they're at. So look at different ways of doing it in advance.
So, yep, absolutely.
I'm coming at it from the candidate perspective.
Yep.
So I've been in IT sales for about 8 years. So yep. I've seen a lot of change. The average life cycle for IT salespeople at the moment is 16 months.
Yep.
Right. So think of it from a business perspective, you're turning people that quickly. Now that's average. So if you've got 5 year people, that means you've got people coming in out of the business within 4 to 6 months.
Yep.
There is a talent shortage.
Yep.
But there's also a mismatch between what organisations are looking for and what the market can support.
Yep.
The biggest issue right now that I've seen, especially COVID's highlighted it really in a big way, is that it is now a buyer's market. Because of the ubiquitous nature of the internet, because of the fact that buyers are more educated about what they're going to purchase, if you are a walking brochure quota crusher, you are heading the way of the Tyrannosaurus Rex. Because the buyer doesn't want that sleek walking brochure to walk in and go, hey, I've got a deal for you. What they actually want is somebody who can deliver business insight. But the job ads that are coming out are, you know, quota crusher, this, that, you know, lead gen by yourself, no marketing support, what it suggests. There's this actual mismatch between what organizations are looking for and what the market will tolerate. And I think that's part of the education process that needs to happen, is that if you're going to put a job ad in market, don't ask for something that your customers will not want to deal with,
yep,
fundamentally.
And well, I think one of the things that's probably driving that also at the moment is if you went back 6 months, clients probably felt like they could go and hire a unicorn. They could go and find that spangly pink unicorn with the really pointy horn on it that is 20 inches long rather than whatever size it might be. That market's changed, but a lot of clients probably haven't moved with the market, I don't think, in terms of that. They still want the unicorn.
Well, the thing is, they want what last worked for them. Okay? If you're an IT company out of the US and you're listed on the NASDAQ, say you're even an Oracle, you won't give your sales team huge, great big targets. You'll give them a target, like it's $1 billion gross profit you want from that particular salesperson. You'll do it and you replicate that across the board, knowing that some of the salespeople aren't going to hit their targets, others are going to blow it out of the water, because they need to make sure that they get their quarterly, 6 monthly and yearly figures so that they keep the share prices up. So that's what tends to happen with them.
I think that goes back to, do you know what you want? And is what you want the right thing? Just going to move through this. So that brings us on to, what are you actually looking for? And I'm going to let Richard talk to describe.
So, yeah, so this is what I call the ideal candidate. So the ideal candidate is 100%. We've got three basic areas here. Can they do the job, which is the skills? Will they do the job, which is the attitude? And fit is fit. Okay. What you're looking for an ideal hire is you're looking for about a 75 to 80% in that. So, skills. So this is the skills angle here, and you can see there's a gap there. Now, the thing is with skills, if you hire a candidate that doesn't have all the skills, what you'll tend to find is you can train them yourselves to fill that skill gap. And a really good candidate will, this is their impetus when they come into the role, they'll want to try and close that skill gap as quickly as they possibly can. So if you hire somebody that you only want the skills, what tends to happen then is that they've got no impetus when they come into the organisation. There's nothing to close. You've got the industry sector experience, you've got everything that they want, all the skills, but you'll find them potentially a pretty average employee. Attitude, you can't train. Absolutely, you can't train. And fit, you can't train either. So what I'm saying is, look for, obviously some of these skills over here are going to be non-negotiable. You're going to have them, but you don't want a candidate that's got everything. So you're looking for a 75 to 80% fit, but do not compromise on attitude and do not compromise on fit. Andrew?
Yeah, I agree with that. And what most people try and do, where the unicorn comes in, is you're looking for 100% or 95%.
They tend to be the worst hires, when you're looking for that, and you're tempted, you'll go, oh, you know what? Look, I've got all the skills we want. I'm not sure they're a great fit, but we'll try them. Okay, and I'll tell you what,
it doesn't matter.
That's the worst thing you can possibly. Only hire on the skills gap. That's it.
It doesn't work, and often that comes down to how long you've interviewed someone. In terms of your conversation, and actually you'll find the interviews a far better interview if you've done that piece. If you go back to the new process, if you've done that piece at the start, you've actually been talking to them before then, you'll get a lot more out of the interview as well. So it's a little bit about investing that time up front. And then with the interview, that's probably a slightly different version to what most people do, and Rich is going to talk to this.
Yeah. So a good interview runs something like this. You tell your story. So thanks very much, Peter, for coming in. Really appreciate it. What I want to do is I want to tell you a bit about the organisation that we're working for, that we are, and where we're going and what our trajectory is. That's what you need to sort of think about. And then you need to sort of talk about all of that and maybe the context of why you're hiring this particular one. Then after that, you say to the candidate, can you tell me a bit about you? That's the equivalent. And if they've done that really well, then after about 20 minutes, what happens is that you think, oh my God, I've got a great candidate here, or I've got a good candidate here at all. Okay. And what happens if you've got a really good candidate is that the interview will change and the interview questions will generally fall down by the wayside and you'll start going, you know what? I want to talk to Peter about the problems and challenges that I'm facing in the organisation. And it becomes much more of a business discussion rather than an interview. Now, if that's the way it's working, you've probably got yourself a great candidate sitting in front of you. If you still find that you're interviewing a candidate at the hour mark, you're probably not going to hire them. To be fair,
yeah.
You're probably not going to hire them. And the other thing
questions, yes? Then I'll ask their questions. Now, I've had people get hired purely on the questions that they ask. And I think, you know, that's the insightful thing. Are they genuinely interested in the role? Are they genuinely interested in the organisation, your organisations? Are they genuinely interested in them? Yes? Hang on, just...
I just wanted to capture that point because I thought it was a really interesting one. Are you saying that if you're still interviewing at an hour, not having a business discussion, you're generally not going to hire them because you're still in that interview process, you haven't got a good few years to get in the script, and it's really just an interview?
You're probably starting to go, out of my flipping office. I've booked them in for an hour, and I've got, you know, and you're just thinking, oh my God, I've got to keep them here for another 20 minutes. Get them out of my office.
I think a key part to the process, and where some people get that interview process wrong, is their first question is, tell me about yourself, rather than actually selling the story. Now, what we were going to do was run a couple more group exercises, but I've got someone at the back who's holding up 10 fingers, which I think is telling me that I've got about 10 minutes. Yeah, Rob. So I think what's important, that story piece is important, and actually the people who were here for Peter's workshop premiere, was it 3 months ago? I think a lot of that is coming into this. This is about your ability to get your story across. And I think where a lot of businesses, or when you're interviewing, it goes slightly wrong, you start talking about the job. You know what? The candidate's not interested in the job, really. Yeah, they're interested in the job. They're interested about the opportunity. And what they want to hear is your passion about your business coming through. What's the opportunity for me to be able to grow? Where does that sit? So you've got to get your why across, your passion across. And now all of a sudden they're invested in the interview. If you go into straight, tell me about yourself, why are they invested, particularly if it's straight from a Zeek interview, why are they invested in you and how do they know what they're talking to?
Exactly.
Just from your experience, how many of your clients know that story themselves?
No, I would suggest not enough of them.
Not very many of them. So I think that's probably the thing. So the other thing is, as humans, we are definitely hardwired to listen to stories. Absolutely hardwired. And Peter talked about this in his presentation. We are what I say when I talk about storytelling is that we are Stone Age people living in a digital age. Okay, we are built for the Stone Age. If you could imagine our ancestors not that far, not that long ago, that people were sitting around a fire, okay, listening to stories in the middle of the night. We are hardwired to listen to them. The storytellers of today are the people that do TED Talks. They are the Michael McIntyre, the comedian. They can hold the whole audience in their hand. You need to build a compelling story about the company that you're working for and the job and the aspirational aspects around the job to get the right candidate interested in the role. And what will happen is when you ask them to tell them their story, hopefully their story will overlap what you're looking for, and then you'll know whether you've got yourself a good candidate so you can phone them.
And that will come down to, so we're not going to go through this, but what I think Richard and I are both happy to do, if anyone wants to have a look at their story, have a look at how they interview and how they go through a process, then Richard and I are both happy to have a look at that individually.
What do you think of the STAR interview technique, situation, task, action, result?
Yep. There's absolutely no question that behavioural interview questions are absolutely vitally important, because at the end of the day, past behaviour is indicative of future behaviour, right? So what would you do if, or what happened when, you know, so if you've got a sales job that you're trying to sell, don't talk about, oh, well, did the person make quota in the last couple of years? Ask them a question around, how did you turn, what
when was the last time you turned a customer around, the one that was just about to go or that had left the organisation 2 years before and they then became part of your portfolio? Can you talk to me about how you did that? That's a genuine question, right? Because at the end of the day, you're going to get a story, hopefully. And if it's all waffle and people don't understand it, you haven't got the right flipping candidate sitting in front of you. It doesn't matter how well dressed they are. It doesn't matter, you know, whatever. If they're not right and you can't relate to it, there should be no wrong and right answers in terms of, you know, the answers that you were expecting to get back. There's nothing like that. It's, can you relate to what the candidate was talking to you about? And if you can, then you've probably got the right candidate sitting in front of you.
So just in terms of time as well, because this is something I think that often gets missed, and that is you need to expect questions from a candidate, and you need to give them the chance to answer them, the chance to ask those questions, because one of the things hopefully you've got out of this interview is a two-way process. It's actually not an interview, it's a storytelling process. You've both got stories to tell, and do those stories, could they end up in the same almanac? So questions that you're likely to expect, probably something around the culture, something around the role, the company, the industry, you, and just think about, are they questions that you want the person to be asking? Do they match with what's important to you and what you're looking for? Because the questions a candidate asks will tell you a lot about them, what's important to them, and what they're engaged with. In terms of the candidates, we'll generally advise sometimes candidates in terms of what types of questions to ask, and the types of questions I'll get them to ask are around, in terms of culture, what do you like about working here, rather than what quite often gets asked, can you tell me about the culture of your company?
Or, you know, a good question for a candidate to ask you might be, so I've noticed on your LinkedIn profile that you've been here a couple of years. What changes have you spotted? What changes have you noticed in the organisation since you joined the company? That's a really good one, because at the end of the day, that's telling you, A, they've looked at your LinkedIn profile, B, they're interested in you, C, they've bothered to remember that you've been only with the company for a couple of years. It's a genuinely good question, and it tells you what's important to them.
In summary, I can see someone moving in the background. Try and be as proactive as you can and stay ahead of the market. Get your process right and make sure that you can make it flexible and fast. Know what you're looking for. And actually, just on that, which I didn't go into before, if you've got four people who are going to end up interviewing this person, make sure that you're all telling the same story. You'd be surprised how often you're looking for different things and you start telling different stories. Understand what you actually want from the interview process. And this bit's really important. It's as much about the candidate as it is about you. And if you can make it more candidate-centric, I think you'll end up with more candidates and better candidates and people who are invested in your process.
If anybody's doing a hiring process and they want me to help them devise some interview questions for them so that they can figure out whether they've got some genuinely good open interview questions, I'm happy to have a chat to anybody about that, as long as all I need to do is find out about what it is that you're looking to hire, and then I'll give you the interview questions.
And I'm happy to do the same. If anyone's got any questions, you'll need to be really quick, because otherwise you'll get interrupted.